Most people are totally unaware of the signs of their heritage, their history that lie around them. As is the case here in this sleepy village in Littleborough in the Pennine Hills. And as we approach the railway station, we find out information which might be a surprise. For instance, this little insignificant station was opened by no less than George Stephenson. Now that's the same George Stephenson who invented the rocket, one of the first ever successful steam locomotives. As an engineer, he was involved in the opening of the tunnel which linked Yorkshire with Lancashire, the Summit Tunnel. Now, Littleborough was a textile town like so many towns in this region and relied upon the canals for transport. But of course, with the coming of the railways, things started to change and there was competition for the goods that needed to be moved. Emerging from this underpass, we came across a hill. And this particular hill, at the crest and over the back, there was coal mining. Between the railway line on my right and the coal mine was the canal. Now the canal was originally used to move the coal. And children as young as 6 years old would bring down the coal on trolleys, on tram lines or railway lines, and carry them across to the railway station. But of course, before the railway, there was the canal, which had been built to act as a lifeline, allowing goods to be transported from Leeds to Manchester, or vice versa. These sites here were the moorings for the boats that would pull up and deliver their goods. These rings down here on the ground are where the boats would have moored. They're still here, though most people walk past them without realising their existence. This is the remnants of the mechanism that would have been used for carrying the raw cotton bales from the boats into the weaving sheds, and obviously finished goods back onto boats to be moved up again along the canal. Only the ground floor of the lock keeper's cottage is the original. We can see the original stonework there, but subsequently another floor was added, and then eventually the unit on the right where the conservatory now stands. And the water behind me at Hollingworth Lake was originally a reservoir, but eventually the water from that was pumped up 200 feet to supply the canals, which obviously the water needs restoring as it drains away. And the water was sent up to Summit. Now there's a row of cottages here which are interesting in themselves, in that when we stop and look, we look at the material they're made from, and they're neither brick nor local stone. Now in fact these cottages are made out of cement. They were done as a trial just to test the durability of the material. But there are none other to be seen round here which suggests the trial was a failure. And yet the fact they're still standing after all these years suggests the trial was a success. Of course the story is the same everywhere. These areas were originally agricultural areas. And when people wanted to bring workers in, they had to attract them from miles around. To my right was originally a mill. And these houses will have been built by the mill owners to house the key workers. Textiles were always a part of life in this area because when making material you always need a damp atmosphere. And of course this part of Lancashire is always known for a damp atmosphere, though we do have good weather sometimes. This field was actually used, the slope was used to dry materials on hooks. Now, when material is finished, it has to be stretched and it would be hung on a set of hooks and called tenter hooks. Now you might have heard this expression, when people say they're on tenter hooks, that means their nerves are stretched to the maximum. But in fact, the material would have been laid out on this field, attached by hooks, tensioned and left to dry in the sun. But also, the field serves more of a purpose than that. Because in fact, if we walk up the slope, if I'm right, we should find a water supply. Because of course water was absolutely essential to the whole of the textile industry. Yes, sure enough, here we are. This is a lodge. Now some of the mills would have been water powered. I've no idea if this one would have been. But in fact the water was necessary for a lot of the processes involved in making the materials. And from this end of the mill lodge we come across one of the earliest buildings, still intact. We can see the style of windows again as suited the mill cottage on one level. And again, if we look at the roof, we see the original stone that was used to make the tiles. At the back, we've got a storage area. May have been used as an outhouse later on, but again, all these materials would have been dug out of the ground nearby and put to use. As we approach the cottage, if we look down, we'll suddenly see a row of flagstones on one side. Now, originally there would have been flagstones on both sides, and maybe further up the track we'll see that. But as we stop by the cottage, we can see the original building. In these days, of course, there'd have been no gas or electricity, so the only light available would have been daylight or perhaps an oil lamp. Therefore, they had as many windows as possible to make as much use of the light as they could. And of course, the windows were upstairs where the weaving would have taken place. And of course, the other thing about the glass at that time is glass couldn't be made in large sheets. So generally, windows had very small pieces of glass in them, but these were quite long because they're modern replacements. But the original ones would have been small pieces of glass because that was the nature of the glassmaking trade. Yes, I was right. I said we found extra sets now. We've got on the left and we've got on the right. Now, these are typical because this would have been a dirt path down the centre, which most people would have walked on. But of course, once you needed trucks carrying materials, you'd have wanted something a bit more resilient. And that would be the reason why they'd be building flagstones in there. And you can see even in the centre where they've been worn away, where you've got the gathering of the water. So again, another sign of what's taken place in the past. Roads we take for granted nowadays. Now, this was the main road that led up to Yorkshire, so this would have been made as a proper road. But most of the tracks around here were nothing more than dirt tracks. So private enterprise took over and people built toll roads. And the toll roads, of course, were substantial material. You weren't likely to get bogged down. The prices were 5 pence for sheep or lambs, 10 pence for cattle for every 20 of them. And every coach drawn by 6 horses or more was 2 shillings, so of course this is old money. Individual horses, mules or asses, whether they were carrying anything or not, were 1 penny. And every wagon or carriage carrying people was 1 shilling. Textiles were carried, finished goods were carried from Lancashire here, right down here to Todmorden, through into Yorkshire. Graveyards are always very good sources of information, whether it's when people died, age range. In this particular example, we can tell from this gravestone that this woman had 2 sons in the 1900s, one who died in Africa, one who died in America. We also get good ideas of the ages at which people died. Here's a boy, age 2, his brother was age 4. We don't know what they died from, but it gives you an idea of just what child mortality was like at that time. Amongst all these laid down gravestones, there's one standing. Now clearly this is the grave of somebody important. Look who I am, I'm obviously significant, and sure enough, it's Lawrence Newell. The Newells were the major landowners in this area. They owned virtually everything. And they were quite generous. They obviously owned factories and stuff and employed a lot of locals. But at the same time, they turned over a lot of the land to park areas, a cricket ground, which is still in use today. As we come out of the cemetery, we come across the original inn that was here. This coach house is where the horses of travellers would have been stabled. They'd have been stabled over there in that block, fed and watered. Accommodation would have been here. And obviously people would then set off either up the toll road over there up to Todmorden, or they'd take the non-toll road, which would be of inferior quality, but that would go up to Halifax. The slope of the hill was so steep that, of course, modern cars can manage it, but in those days horses couldn't. So as a result, at the bottom of the hill, more horses would have to be added to the first lot to get them up here. And when they eventually arrived here at the White House, then the horses were disconnected and walked back down the hill again for the next users. So originally the transport, the lifeblood of this area, was the canals. And of course they were later taken over by the railways. So now it's the turn of the railways to lose their business, the roads. Where we go in the future, no one can tell. But what is obvious is that signs of our history are around us, if only people will take the time to look.